Acts chapter 2. We were talking about Elijah and Elisha last week. And we kind of concluded in this area. And I want to pick up kind of where we left off deal with some things. 2 Kings 2, 1 through 14. When the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven in a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way to Gilgal. And Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, the Lord has sent me to Bethel." But Elisha said, "As surely as the Lord lives and you live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel, and the company of the prophets at Bethel came out to Elisha and asked, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from you today?" "Yeah, I know. I don't talk about it. Leave me alone. Be quiet." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here as you live. I will not leave you." And so they went to Jericho. The company of the prophets at Jericho went up to Elijah and said, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from you today?" "Yeah, I know, I know, I know, I know. Leave me alone. Be quiet." He said, Elijah said to him, "Stay here. The Lord sent me to Jordan." He said, "Surely as the Lord lives, I will not leave you." So the two of them walked on, and 50 men from the company of the prophets went and stood at the distance facing the place where Elijah and Elisha had stopped at the Jordan. And Elijah took his cloak, a mantle, a garment, rolled it up, and struck the water with it. And the water divided to the right and to the left, and the two of them crossed over on dry ground. You know, this isn't the only time that people have walked on dry ground before. It happened one time in the book of Exodus with the children of Israel. And when they crossed on dry ground, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I can do for you before I'm taken." "Let me inherit a double portion of your spirit," Elisha said. "You have asked a difficult thing," Elijah said. "But if you see me when I'm taken from you, it will be yours. Otherwise, it will not." And as they were walking along and talking together, suddenly a chariot of fire and horses of fire appeared and separated the two of them. Can I say this real quick? That sometimes the greatest thing you're waiting on in your life is going to come after separation first. There's got to be some separation from people sometimes before you can get what you're praying for. There might have to be some separation that takes place. And as he went up in the whirlwind, Elisha saw this and cried out, my father, the chariots and horsemen of Israel." And Elisha saw him no more. And then he took hold of the garment and tore it in two. And Elisha then picked up Elijah's cloak, the mantle, the garment that Elijah struck the water with, same garment. He picked it up, and he went back and stood on the bank of the Jordan, and he took the cloak that had fallen from Elijah, and he struck the water with it. He struck the water with it. "Where now is the Lord, the God of Elijah?" Elisha said. And when he struck the water, it divided to the right and to the left, and he crossed over. I want to talk to you today on the phrase, "It's time to strike." It's time to strike. I'm going to pray with you, and then I want you to be seated. Lord, today we ask that you open our hearts and minds to receive your words. I pray today that if there's anything that's causing us distraction, that would allow us not to get what you want out of this word today, I pray that you would remove the distraction. Lord, I pray that you would anoint me your messenger. Lord, let me speak your word, and let these people be responsive to your word. We pray today, God, that you would give us a new outlook on the word, and give us a new outlook into our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. It's time to strike. It's time to strike. If you remember last week, we talked about Elisha burning his plow, and I had brought my little tiller up here. Everybody remember that last week, the tiller? And so I took it home. Sorry. I left it up here on Wednesday night, and some of the youth were trying to crank it, so I figured I'd better take it home before they started plowing up the carpet and everything else up here. I'm trying to put corn up here or something. But we talked about Elisha burning his plow. And remember, what I was telling you last week was that if you're holding on to your plow, you can't get to where God wants you to be. And there's many times where people are trying to get where God's wanting them to go, but they're still holding on to their plow. You remember that? Everybody remember what I'm talking about? And so we talked about how you can't just burn the plow, but you got to burn the oxen. You can't just burn half of it. You got to burn all of it. You can't just get rid of parts of it, but if you don't get rid of all of it, you'll try to go back to what you're trying to burn. And so we got to burn the plow. We got to get rid of the plow. And many of us are grabbing hold of the plow, walking around with it, saying, God, open doors for me, but make sure it's wide enough to fit my plow through. God, help me get up the mountain, but make sure I can carry my plow with me as I go up the mountain. And we talked about how the plow can be a person. It can be a job. It can be something that you're upset about. It could be a forgiveness problem. It can be bitterness. It can be whatever your plow. Maybe you know what your plow is. I've got a plow. You've got a plow. We all have plows that we have to get rid of. So I want to, I kind of want to show you that, but I also want to tell you that it's important to note that you'll never get your double portion unless you get rid of the plow. Yeah? Because as long as you're holding on to the plow, you'll never follow where you're supposed to go. If Elisha would have been plowing up the field still when Elijah went up the chariots of fire, then he would have never saw the mantle fall from heaven. But the fact that he burned his plow, walked away from it, said, I'll never leave you, Elijah. I'll be wherever you're going. I'm going to Jericho with you. I'm going to the Jordan with you. I'm going to Bethel with you. I'm going wherever you're going, because where you're at is where I want to be. And we said that wherever God is where we want to be. And we don't want anything to get in the way of where God wants us to be. And so if we're not burning our plow, we're probably not going to experience what God wants us to experience. Well, in this passage, finally, Elisha gets what he's waited on. Finally, Elijah goes up, and remember what he said in the scripture. He said that Elijah said, what can I do for you? And Elisha said, when you go up, I just want a double portion of your spirit. I want a double portion of your anointing. I want to feel a double portion of what you have for me. And Elijah said, if you see me when I go up, that's the key. If you see me when I go up, you'll see the blessing come back down. But you've got to be there. You've got to be there. That's an important test. If you're not there, you won't receive it. If you're not there, you're not going to get it. If you're not at that point, you're not going to feel it. If you're not there, you're not going to get it. And a lot of people, I feel, are seeking something from God. And the reason they're not getting it is because they're not there. They're not there. They're not there. And Elisha was there, and he grabbed the mantle. He grabbed the cloak. He grabbed that garment. And as he grabbed it, he took the garment just like Elijah did. And it's funny, he walked straight over to the Jordan, which was just parted. The funny thing, I started reading, I guess I read too much into things because I dissect and I spend all week. You know, while you're working jobs, I'm out here dissecting Scripture. And so I'm all week long, I'm dissecting Scripture. And so I have time to think about dumb things. And so the dumb thing that I thought was what never said the water came back down. It just said that Elijah struck the water and it divided on the right and left, but it never said the water came back down. So I'm thinking, did Elijah get on the other side and go, okay, now you can fall down? And it never said he struck the ground again. You know, when the Red Sea parted and they went through, they come on the other side and Moses stretched his rod out again. The water went back on the chariots and all the men and it killed them. But the Jordan River, was it just sitting there? You know, can you see it for like 30 minutes? People walking by. You see the water parted. I don't know. I think about these things all week while you guys are being mature. I'm out thinking about goofy stuff. And so I don't know. But all I know is that it must have fell back down sometime or another, because Elisha took the mantle and he walked back over to the Jordan River. And the Bible gives a specific instruction that he did. It didn't say that he put his toe in the water or put his finger down there. It didn't say that he looked at it and said anything. It said that he picked up the mantle and he struck the water. He picked up the mantle and he struck it. He didn't wave it. He didn't put it in there and move it around. He didn't touch the water. He didn't barely ease into it. He struck the water. And he said, if you're still the God of Elijah and you're the God of me, basically, then allow this water to do what it did with Elijah. Where's the God of Elijah? And so he struck the water and the Bible said it parted, just like it did with Elijah. The same God. The same God. The same God. The same God that did it for Elijah did it for Elisha. The same God that did it for Elisha can do it for you. The same God that did it for Moses can do it for you. The same God of Daniel, He can do it for you. The same God of David, He can do it for you.
And it was interesting as I was reading this text that it said strike, and I thought, well, that's an interesting way to put it, that he struck the water. He didn't raise his hand over the water, but he hit the water. He struck the water.
If you think about, I was thinking about boxing a little bit. And can you imagine if you told a boxer, while you're boxing and you're trying to defeat your opponent, I don't want you to strike them. I just want you to tap them. Just tap them. Now, they're going to try to kill you, but I want you to just tap them back. They're going to try to take you out, but I want you to just kind of tap them. You know what we do with the enemy sometimes? We're trying to tap him. Move along. There's going to have to come a time in your life to where you're going to have to get out the anointing in the presence of God and strike your enemy with what you're trying to defeat him with. You can't tap him. You can't tiptoe with him. You can't play with him. You can't just speak to him. You're going to have to strike him with something. The greatest strike that you've got is the Word of God. You can strike your enemy with the Word of God. You can strike your enemy with the name Jesus. The Bible says that at the name Jesus, demons tremble. So when he comes against you, instead of just playing around with him and tiptoeing with the enemy when he's trying to take you out, won't you just start saying, Jesus, 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 Jesus. Because when you say that, he's trembling all over. He can't do nothing with you when you're speaking Jesus, when you're talking Jesus. And so at this point, I want you to note that as he strikes the water, there's other people around. And they see this. And they see what's going on. I don't have time to get into that part of it, but as they're watching what's going on, it's almost like he's auditioning to see if he's going to be as great as Elijah. Because think about it. Three times, these people kept coming up to Elisha saying, don't you know that Elijah's leaving? Don't you know that Elijah's going up? And every time Elisha goes, hey, you guys hush. I don't want to talk about it. I don't want to talk about it. I don't want to talk about Elijah leaving me. Can you just be quiet? Can you just stop talking about it? Because I don't want to talk about it anymore. I'm just tired of talking about it. Have you ever dealt with people in your life? You just keep telling them, I don't want to talk about it. You know? I don't want to. I'll give you a little. Y'all feel sorry for me a little bit. You probably won't, but. So, listen, I went to the doctor for her 28-week checkup. And baby's perfect. Everything's great. She's in there moving around like hotcakes. She is very active. She's shooting ball. I know what she's doing there. We're there. Doctor's talking to her. We get done. I really like this doctor. I mean, I truly do. And, so we get done at the, you know, talking to him, and at the end of the appointment, I'm sitting there in my chair, and the doctor looks at Melissa and says, you know, next time you come in, we're going to have to get your Tdap shot. I said, what's that? He said, well, it's tetanus and whooping cough and something else. When he said shot, I was a little lost anyway, because I don't function when we talk about needles. He lost me. And I really like this doctor. I mean, he's kind of like a grandfather figure. I mean, he just walks in, he talks to you, loves on you, he hugs you. He's great. We really like this guy. And then he looked at me and said, you need to get the Tdap shot too. And I said, I ain't paying you for that. I didn't come for that. I came for the baby. I came to hear the heartbeat. I came from Melissa, but I didn't come to you to tell me I got to get a shot, you know. And if that's what I'm here for, I don't like you no more, you know. He kind of started laughing because he said my face started turning white a little bit, like whiter than normal. And he's like, are you okay, sir? And I said, no, I'm really not. I'll tell you that to tell you this. First of all, I want you to feel sorry for me. Second of all, I'm saying that
so that you understand something, that there are going to be situations that you're going to be put in life, in general, that you're not going to particularly want to do, and you're not going to particularly like it. There are certain things you can get out of in life, and I've tried to weasel my way out of the shot, and it's not happening. My wife's not going to let me get out of it. My mom and dad's not going to let me get out of it. My mother-in-law's not going to let me get out of it. I don't think God's going to let me get out of this. So somewhere along the line, I'm going to have to get my T-Dap shot. I'm taking one for the team. That's it. Little Amelia better love me forever. Just homie don't do shots. But so in life, we have a decision to make. Sometimes our decision is countered by Satan's ability to try to get us to stop where we are and not move on any further. It's kind of like we're getting ready to walk into something, and he wants to counter that to make us stop where we are, dead in our tracks, and not keep going any further. Because we're kind of afraid to keep moving on because of what we're having to face along the way. And there are so many people today, in my opinion, there are so many people today in this room, in your, you know, walk with God, that you are standing holding the mantle of God, holding the Spirit of God, holding what God's put in your hands, and you have yet to strike the water. And you have yet to reach down, and you're tiptoeing, but you're not striking. And it's coming to a point in your life right now to where I'm going to tell you the way everything's going, and I try not to dwell on the world and all this stuff because I can't control that anyway. But just in general, there comes a point in time in your life to where you're going to have to learn to strike the water. You're going to have to stop tiptoeing around it and actually put some works with your faith. You've got to put some works with your faith. It's great to have faith. You need all the faith you can get, but faith without works is dead. It means nothing. And Elisha could have took that mantle and said, I've got the faith that this thing's going to part that water, but until he struck the water, nothing happened. You see that? It takes an action accompanying with your faith. He saw it before, but now it's time for him to do it. And so all these people, again, are kind of gathered around, they're watching, and it's kind of like an audition's taking place. It's kind of like, is Elisha going to be like Elijah? And I thought about American Idol a little bit. I actually contemplated on showing some clips of American Idol auditions, as awful as they really are. But I decided not to because I might have lost some of you and wouldn't be able to finish preaching. But there are some really bad American Idol auditions. I can't think of, you know, a really good one to try to sing for you. But anybody ever watched American Idol? You ever watched American Idol? You know that they show more bad ones than good ones a lot of times, you know. And I was talking to somebody who actually auditioned for American Idol, and they're a friend of mine, and they went on there, and they didn't make the cut. And I was kind of shocked that they didn't because they're really, really good. But they said you start off in a gym. You don't actually start off in front of, who are the people? Jennifer Lopez and who's the country guy? Keith Urban, yeah. And whoever else they have, sometimes they go back and forth. So you don't actually start off in front of them. You actually go into this big gymnasium or auditorium or something, and you audition for individual people. And then if they like you good enough, then they send you on to somebody else. And then sometimes they send you to somebody else before you get to Keith Urban and Jennifer Lopez and other people that do that. And this is what I don't understand. How is it that some guy or some girl cannot sing at all? They sound like muddy water running through a cow's nose, whatever that sounds like. And it's ridiculous. It's the worst sound ever. But yet they can make it past three people to get to Keith Urban? No. You know how that works? They said, this is good for television. You know what I mean? Melissa likes to watch these reality TV shows. No. They're as fake as it gets. I don't care what any of you say. The Bachelor and the Bachelorette are rigged. Thank you. I'm not getting a rose today. But there's auditions for these particular parts. And so everybody, I'm just giving you an idea, everybody's gathered and they're watching Elisha audition for the part. Is he good enough to be Elijah? Well, can I tell you something? That when he struck the water that particular day, he started on a brand new journey in his life, and he did double the miracles Elijah did. Why? Why? He said, I want a double portion. I want something double of what you have. I want to be greater than you. I want to see greater things than you saw. I want to do things that you never done, Elijah. But how do I do that? He said, if you're here, when I go up, you will receive the mantle. And guess what? When Elisha got that, he didn't have to audition. He already had the part. He already had the part. And the reason that you have the part that you have is because of what Jesus did when he came. When Jesus said, it is finished, he gave you the part. You don't have to audition for what he wants you to do. You don't have to audition to have his grace and his love and his mercy. There is no audition for the love of Jesus. You don't have to audition for the part. He said, the part has been played. I played the part. I beat the part. I rose the part. I am the part. I am the life. And because I am, you am. You have something. You have love. You have grace. So why do we feel like we have to audition? Why do we feel like we have to audition for our parts? Like we're not good enough. Like we're not good enough. John 14, 12 through 14. I want to show you another scripture. John 14, 12 through 14. It said, verily, this is Jesus, verily, verily, I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will even do greater things than these. And this is why. Because I'm going to the Father, and I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. You may ask anything, me for anything in my name, and I will do it. Wait a minute. That means we'll see greater things than Jesus saw? That's what it said. It said, greater things will you do in my name. Greater things shall you do in my name. Why? Because I go to the Father. But there's another part of this that I didn't type up and didn't do the scripture, so I'll just kind of tell you. It says, greater things will you do in my name. Okay. It says, because he's going up to the Father. What does that mean? That means when Jesus went up, he sent something back down. It said that Jesus told his disciples that it's expedient. I have to leave you. I have to leave you. I have to go. Well, why do you have to go, Jesus? Well, please don't leave us. We'll go. Peter said, I'll go wherever you go. Don't you remember Peter saying, I'll do whatever you do. I'll go wherever you go. People were telling Jesus, I'll follow you wherever you go. I'll do whatever you want to do. And they said, why do you have to leave? And Jesus said, because if I don't go, then the Spirit can't come back. But if I leave, I'll send the Spirit down, and he'll be able to live inside of you. That means the same Spirit that Jesus, the same power that Jesus had, now lives inside of you. That same Spirit, you know what that Spirit is? It says the same power that raised Jesus from the dead lives inside of you. So that means that when Jesus went up, he sent something back down. That sounds familiar. That sounds familiar. That sounds a little bit familiar. It sounds like does that mean that it almost sounds a little bit like what happened with Elijah and Elisha? Yeah? Because Elijah went up, the mantle came back down, and now there's a double portion that came back down with Elisha, and now Elisha's possessed something greater than he ever had before, but it took Elijah going up for him to receive it. It took Jesus going up for his Spirit to come back down, and now we have the power to strike our enemy and strike the water and strike our problem and strike anything that comes our way. Because of him going up, we received something because the Spirit came back down. And now because of that, we have power. We have power to do great things in his name. I think that Maybe the reason we're not seeing the things that we want to see in our life, it could be because of the plow. It could be because of the plow. But after you get past the plow, it could just be that all of us are standing on the edge of the water. And we realize once we strike it, we got to fight. Which takes me to my next scripture, my last scripture. I want to show you right quick. I'm almost done. 2 Kings 13. Now, I don't know if you've ever read this scripture. Maybe you have and maybe didn't pay attention to it. But as I've been thumbing through the Bible and reading, I kind of got intrigued by this last passage. And I want to show you something that maybe you didn't know, maybe you did know. I didn't know it until I started studying. 2 Kings 13, 14 through 19. When Elisha was in his last illness, King Joash of Israel visited him and wept over him. My father, I see the chariots and the charioteers of Israel, he cried. And Elisha told him, basically Elisha's getting ready to die. This is the end of his life. Things are getting ready to pass on. And this is Elisha's last little thing here, he says. He says, get a bow. I love it. He said, get a bow and some arrows. And the king did, as he was told. And Elisha said, put your hand on the bow. Elisha laid his hands on the king's hands. And then he commanded, open the eastern window. And he opened it and he said, shoot. And so he shot an arrow. Elisha proclaimed, this is the Lord's arrow, an arrow of victory over Aram, for you will completely conquer the Aramans and Aphek. And then he said, now pick up the other arrows, here's what gets Israel, and strike them against the ground. So the king picked them up and struck the ground three times. But the man of God was angry with him. Wait a minute. He was mad? And that was, Elisha told him to strike the ground, and he struck the ground, but he struck the ground three times. And he was angry with him. He said, you should have struck the ground five or six times. Then you would have defeated and beaten Aram until it was entirely destroyed. What? But now, you want to be victorious three times. That don't make any sense. Kind of a weird scripture. I read it this week, and I'm like, Elisha, you're weird, man. What are you mad at the king for? He did what you told him to do. He struck the ground. Just because he struck it three times and didn't strike it as many times as you wanted to, five or six, what does that matter? Well, I had to do a little research. Maybe it will help us if I give you a little historic background. And this particular day, it wasn't good enough. It wasn't good enough to just defeat your army three times. Because if you only beat them three times, you didn't completely destroy them. You had to beat them five or six times. If you go back and do a little research, the armies didn't fight just once. They fought many times. Because it wasn't a battle, it was a war. And many times to defeat and win your war, you have to defeat somebody several times. So three times wasn't good enough. But five or six times was sufficient. And generally after the fifth or sixth time, you have completely destroyed your enemy. So here's the king, and he picks up his arrow, and he strikes it three times. Right? And Elisha goes, that's not good enough. Now you hadn't done good enough. You should have hit it five or six times. Why did you only do it three times? Why just three? Why not five or six? So I've done a little more research. The reason that the king didn't do it more than five or six, or at least five or six, is because he realized that Elisha said, every time you strike the ground, there's a battle that you have to fight. So he realized, the more I strike, the more I fight. And so he hit the ground three times. And you know what we have? We have Christians who are now only striking three times. Because Christians are getting tired of fighting the same fights, the same battles, the same enemies, the same thing, time after time after time after time. Do you know why people are still fighting the same thing? Is because they're only striking three times. They're not continually striking. You know why families aren't getting put back together like they should? You know why people aren't getting healed like they should? It's because we're spending just one, two, three. We're just striking three times. Because we don't want to keep fighting. It's because we get tired. It's because we realize the more we strike, the more we fight. And the more we're striking, the more we're fighting, the tired we're getting. And it's getting tiresome. If you look around what's going around, it's getting tiresome of having to continue to battle and fight and keep praying for people who never are giving their life to Jesus. It's getting tiresome to continue to just keep going the same thing and getting complacent. And we're striking, but nothing's happened. And we're hitting, and nothing's happened. We're hitting the water, and no water's parting. And we're getting discouraged in doing what we've been instructed to do. The Bible says to pray and fast, and we pray and we fast and we pray and we fast, but we see no miracle. We see nothing happening, and so we get discouraged, and we quit fighting, and we quit striking. But I think what God's really looking for today, I think what God's looking for is somebody to take what you've been given. Somebody to take what God's already given you. Somebody to take the Holy Spirit that you have inside of your life. And instead of just going 1, 2, 3, maybe it's time for us as Christians to just keep striking. Just keep going until we feel something. Just keep praying until something happens. Just keep worshiping until something happens. Just keep seeking God until you feel the presence of God overflow in your life. We got to keep striking the ground. I'm going to strike. I'm going to strike. I'm going to strike. I'm going to keep striking. I'm going to strike until something happens. I'm going to keep striking the water and striking and praying and striking until healing happens. I'm going to strike until my family gets it. I'm going to keep striking and strike and strike and strike. I'm going to hit and hit and hit and pray and fast and worship and pray and fast and worship and pray and give. And I'm going to strike and strike and strike until something happens. When we start giving up after 3, nothing happens. And the reason that we're fighting the enemy the same way that we're fighting the enemy, it's because we're stopping too early. And what do I mean too early? Because I know some of you are sitting there saying, well, I've been praying for this thing for 5 years, and I'm still not seeing anything. Well, could it be that in year 1, your prayer was a little bit different than year 3? I mean, let's think about it. Sometimes our prayer life in year 1 or week 1 is weeping and crying and pleading with God and pouring our heart out to God. But after several weeks and years of that, our prayer can sometimes turn into, well, God, if it's your will, then let it happen. What happened from the person that was praying so hard that they were crying and weeping and begging God? It's because you struck 3 times and nothing happened. Elisha said, if you only strike 3 times, you won't completely win. You've got to strike 5 or 6. We can't play with our enemy. And realizing that when Elisha struck the water, he began a war with Satan. Yeah? There was another time in Elisha's life where he did perform a miracle shortly after this, where basically the economy was hurting for water. The water was nasty. It was undrinkable. Elisha said, give me some salt. Elisha poured a bunch of salt in the water, and the water became clear and drinkable. What is salt? Wait a minute. I think that we are told that we are the salt of the world. Yeah? That means if the salt gets inside of something that is nasty, then the salt can help purify and clean something that's dark and undrinkable. don't know about you, but when I look at our communities and I look at our nation, I look at our world, I see a bunch of nasty stuff going on. I see a lot of polluted water. And I start asking myself, well, God, what can I do about it? Is there anything I can do about it? And God spoke to me this week. And He said, too many of my people are standing on the outside of the water waiting for me to give an instruction. And His instruction to His people is to take what you have. Strike. Strike the water. You want to see the healing and take place? Then you've got to keep striking until it happens. You can't give up and throw in the towel just because it's not happening soon enough. Yes, with every strike means another battle. Just like when Elisha said, with every strike you're hitting is another battle. And the king stopped after three because he got tired of fighting. I wish the children of God, myself included, I wish that we all would just keep striking, even if we have to keep fighting. Even if the devil keeps fighting us harder. Because realize something, that when you strike and the enemy comes roaring like a flood, you got angels and legions of angels and the Holy Spirit fighting with you. So every time you strike, another angel steps in. Every time you strike, the Spirit gets stronger. Every time you strike and the devil comes in, you just stand your ground and hold and say, I'm not fighting by myself. The Bible says that the battle is not mine, it's the Lord's. And so every time I have another demon come against me, I'm just going to keep striking. Because I realize that I'm not fighting alone. I've got somebody fighting that's greater than me. And it says that greater is He that is in me than he that is in the world. And if I've got the same power that raised Jesus from the dead living in me, if I've got something great in me, then why not take it out and strike my enemy with it? But the reason we're not doing it is because we don't want to fight. You say I'm wrong, but I know I'm right. I know I'm right. There's some battles you're going to have to fight head on. And you're going to have to do it. And you're going to have to fight harder than you've ever fought before. But I want to tell you one more thing. That if God told you to go into battle, the battle's already been won. But you still have to fight it. He's promised victory. But you still have to fight. So what are we waiting on? What are we waiting on to strike? Don't walk away from your battle. Run to your battle. Remember when David faced Goliath and everybody was hiding behind trees and obstacles? Goliath up there with his big sword shield, remember? And David didn't wait on Goliath to come to him. The Bible said David ran to Goliath. So why are we backing off? Run to it and strike. When David was slinging his little slingshot and the stone came out, it struck Goliath in the head. It was a strike that hit him. Why not strike what's fighting you today? What do I strike it with? Strike it with the only power that can kill it. The power of Jesus. The power of the Spirit. Strike it, hit it, and don't quit hitting it until it dies. Some of the people that are dealing with bad habits and bad issues and trials and things like that, the reason they're continuing to deal with them is because they're not striking them hard enough. They strike them two or three times and they expect it to go away. You have to keep hitting that thing every day. If you're dealing with a battle in your life, you've got to get up every day and strike it before it strikes you. Run to it before it runs to you. Hit it in its face before it can hit you in your face. Don't wait. I'll say this. I gotta stop. Don't wait until the temptation comes to you for you to start praying to get out of the temptation. Pray that God leads you not into temptation. That way, when the temptation comes, you're already geared up and ready for it. It starts coming to you, and you get out your striking material, and you strike that temptation before it can ever get in your head. That's how you fight. You hit it before it hits you. The best place to be in a war, they say, is above, because you can see them coming. Last time I checked, Jesus rose and has risen, and He is above every problem, every situation. So that means He's above everything that fights you. We're not below anything. We're above everything. And so we have the ability to be able to pray, Lord, open my eyes so that I can see when I'm becoming attacked. Let me be able to see that things are coming against me before they even get here. So I am above what's coming above to me. And so that means it's below me so I can strike it before it gets to me. So what do you need to strike today? That's my question. Stand with me. What do you need to strike? What do you need to strike? Bow your heads with me today. Lord, we need to learn. We need to learn how to strike the water before it can strike us. The enemy comes in roaring like a flood. What does that mean? That means that just like with water, we can be flooded. Our lives can be flooded. But if we strike the water before it floods us, we can part it. Somebody needed to hear that. Because you feel like you're getting flooded. There's a flood coming in your life. But I'm here to encourage you that you can part the water before it floods you. That you don't have to have the flood overtake you. You can strike the ground with your arrow. You can strike the ground with that mantle. You don't have to keep falling into that thing. You don't have to keep falling into that thing. I'm going to give you an opportunity today. If you need to strike the water in your life, if you need a miracle, if you need something done in your life today, and you need to strike the water, maybe harder than you've ever struck it before, there's two things. I'm going to ask that you come, and the second thing when you get here is I want you to strike the water, not three times, but five or six. And I don't want you to get up. I don't want you to get up until you feel victory. There's at least 10 people, at least 10 people that God has showed me that He wants to give victory to today. At least 10. There's one. I want you to come. If you need victory in your life of any situation, I want you to come. Come on. If you need to come, step up. There's at least 10. There's two. There's 8 more people at least that God wants to give victory to. Come on, what are you waiting on? I'm telling you, God wants to give it to you today. Why aren't you coming? Why aren't you coming? There's one more. There's 7, at least 7 more people that need to come. There's another one. There's at least 4 more people. Come on. Come on. Don't wait. I can't make you do anything. I can't make you. There's another one. I got 5 more. At least 5 more people. Come on. If you need victory today, I don't know what you're waiting on. I don't know if you're waiting on somebody to grab your hand and bring you down here. Or what? Why don't you just go? I want you to get victory. God wants you to have victory today. I normally don't do this and beg you to come, but I'm begging you to come today because I know what God's promised me. I got 4 more people, at least 4, that needs victory today, and you're waiting. You're waiting. There's 3 more people at least 3 more people that God has promised victory to today. Come on. 3 more people need to come. You know who you are. I never beg you to do this, and I would never do this if God wasn't speaking to me. But you know you need to come today. You're battling something, and you're having a really hard time. I'm begging you to come. I'm begging you to come. Please. Please. Yes. Two more. There's two more. At least two more. Come on. At least two more people need to come. At least two more people need to come. Come on. Come on. They're going to start singing. As they sing, I want you to come. Can we just lift our hands this morning all over this building today? There's a sweet spirit that came in to the place today. We want to honor the Lord, honor His presence. Lord, we thank You that Your Spirit meets with us, strengthens us, gives us what we need. We thank You that Your love ran down that cross through red blood. Because of that blood, we have the victory. We win. We will win. We may have to fight. But that's not going to keep us from striking. We're going to keep striking the ground. If I have to fight five or six times, I'll fight five or six times. But I'm not stopping at three. I'm not stopping at three. Victory. Victory. Lord, for each person today that needs to strike the water. If they didn't do it here, I pray that they'll do it when they get home, in the car. But they've got to strike it. Strike the water. Strike the water. Feel that? Do you feel Him sweeping over you? I know I'm not the only one. You can take a moment and just let Him feel you for a minute. You don't have to rush. Just let him wrap His arms around you today. There's some people that need to feel God wrap His arms around you right now. You can feel that right now. You don't have to rush out of here. Come on, just take a moment and let the Holy Spirit just wrap His arms around you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank You. Thank You, Holy Spirit. I feel You. I feel You wrapping Your arms around me right now. If you feel Him, why don't you lift your hands and just let Him wrap His arms around you right now. Come on, from the back to the front. Let Him do it. Let Him do it. Let Him do it. Let him love on you. He wants to love you. He's right here waiting to love on you. Let Him love on you. Let Him love on you. Let Him love on you. Come on, he's loving somebody right now, and some things are going away in your life because of his love. You don't feel worthy of his love, but you are, because he makes you worthy through his blood. Let him love you. You're fighting his love. Don't fight his love. You don't have to be perfect to receive his love. Quit fighting it. Quit fighting it. I don't know who you are. Somebody's fighting his love. Don't fight his love. Just let him love you. Hallelujah. 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 Love on us, Jesus. Love on us. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. I am here to love you. I am here to strengthen you. I am here to take away your fear and your worry and your pain, if you will just let me do that. I am here to show you that I'm still in control, if you'll let me be in control. I'm here to show you that if you will strike the water, I will part it for you. I am standing beside of you. And the times that you fall to the ground, I will pick you up and carry you through. I've never left you one time. I'm not going to do it now, saith the Lord. Come on. Come on, let him do that. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for speaking to us. Well, let him do that. Let him do that. I'm not rushing. If you need to go, go ahead. I'm not going to rush today. I'll eat when I get to eat. I'll live. Right now, I'm in the presence of God. Come on, just let him love you. Hallelujah. You stand on your word. Stand on your word. We completely trust you. We completely trust you. I'm sorry. Y'all, I'm not sorry for not rushing. This is somebody needed what just happened for those 5 minutes. God's faithful. Let me pray with you. You can stay as long as you like. Lord, I don't even know how to end something like this. so I don't want to end anything. So I'm not going to say I'm ending anything. But I pray the Spirit that's here will leave with us. The same Spirit that we feel right now will leave with us. The peace that you've brought on your people today will leave with us. Lord, I pray today, God, that we would leave in peace. I pray today, God, that when we leave, we would strike the water continually. That we would strike the ground continually. Every day. As Satan comes to us to destroy us, let us strike him before he can strike us. I pray that you would put the power in our lives that we need each and every day, the strength to endure. God, we thank you for the sweet Spirit that you've brought to us today. I pray that as we leave and we go to our homes and restaurants and different things that we do, that that Spirit will follow us. Let other people feel that Spirit. I pray for those who struck the water and struck the ground today. Those that struck it for healing, I pray that you would do that healing. Those that struck it for a financial miracle, for a breakthrough in their life, for family, grant it. They not only had faith, but they put works with it. Grant it. Bless those who can give today, Father, in our tithe and offering. And those that can, I pray that you would bless them. Bless our church. And thank you so much again for your Spirit. Go with us. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. I love you. Have a great week. I'll see you next week.